In Stoicism, externals are outside of your control and hence cannot ultimately give you eudaimonia, the Stoic word for happiness and meaning, something like that, for flourishing. And that is true. Your environment is an external, of course. The people around you are all externals. And ultimately, they're not up to you and they can't grant you happiness. We can't search for happiness in other people. It has to come from within ourselves. However, that is not to say that externals don't have any effect on us. Externals can and do make things easier or harder on us. That's how I understand the idea of luck in Stoicism. If externals work for you, that's good luck. And if they work against you, that's bad luck. Though it's really hard for us to say what is good luck and what is bad luck while we're going through it. You may think that it's bad luck to lose your job, only to find out that in a year when you have a much better job that you wouldn't have gotten unless you got fired, you might look back and say, you know what, that was actually a good thing that I got fired. So the good luck, bad luck thing is not as clear cut as we may think as well. But let's go through some examples here to explain how externals can affect us while still adhering to Stoic philosophy. Because I know it's kind of a weird thing. Does a Stoic change their environment? First, let me use a gym metaphor here. It is a Strong Stoic podcast, and we like gym metaphors. So if you're doing a squat, it is ultimately up to you whether or not you can do it. Now, of course, I'm not saying that you can will yourself and choose to squat 1,000 pounds just by deciding to. I'm not saying that. There's strength limitations that we all have. But I am saying that when you're doing a squat, the focus that you have on it, how much weight you put on it, all of those things factor into whether or not you can do it. But it's really driven by your own success, right? I mean, nobody can squat that weight for you. Imagine you're doing just a regular squat, you have a barbell, and you have some gym clothes on, right? Hopefully. Hopefully you're not squatting in jeans, though with the stretchy fit jeans these days, I suppose you can. Now, this is a very typical squatting situation. We make the squat less likely to be successful, however, by adding externals. So, for example, let's say we have that guy that's squatting a barbell and got some gym clothes on. We could add a blindfold. Now, that's an external. What it does is it throws off the person's balance. We could distract the squatter with someone screaming in the gym, running around naked with melted butter all over himself. Now, how's that for imagery? We could make you wear horrible squatting shoes that make your range of motion just terrible. Now, all of these things, an experienced squatter would probably be able to work through. A good squatter can probably still squat, maybe not as heavy, but they can still squat with a blindfold on, with someone screaming in the background, okay? With horrible squatting shoes. They can still work through it because they're an experienced, competent squatter. However, the externals that we've added still make the squat much harder. In the same way, no, externals cannot give or take away your eudaimonia, but they can make it easier on you in your search for eudaimonia, for deep happiness. Of course, there's another dimension to this, which is time. You see, the externals that we throw at the squatter, the blindfold, someone screaming in the background, horrible squatting shoes, all these externals that we've added, they may actually make the squatter a better squatter. If you do blindfolded squats, your balance will improve and that'll improve your squat. So we have to have a caveat here in the sense that there is this element of time where externals can sometimes immediately work against us, but in the long term, they work for us, which is a very, very odd thing indeed. In the same way, though, if life gives you a lot of stressful situations, stressful work situations, maybe something bad that happened in your personal life, eventually life's less stressful situations will bother you less. So the metaphor has to be taken with a grain of salt in that externals do make us stronger, right? Challenges make us stronger. However, I think it still stands as a useful metaphor. In this very moment, sometimes life is just working against you. And it's easy for you to feel that harmonic sense of eudaimonia when things are going well for you. But what about when they're not going well for you? But that is the lesson. All of that to say, there's nothing unstoic about designing your environment for success. In the same way that our environment can work for us or against us, yet we can still remain our stoic, what would you say, your stoic peace of mind, we can also change our environment and still be aligned with Stoicism. It's this concept that changing your environment can change your success. This is the idea that a lot of successful people work on. The environment that you live in does change you. This is a concept that transcends all organisms. All organisms adapt to their environment, and human beings are, in fact, an organism, so we are no exception. I think going through some examples will be the best way to explain this idea. So here we go. Let's talk about cell phone use. Ooh, it's everybody's favorite topic, right? Let's say you have a goal of reducing your cell phone use. You find yourself using it late at night, avoiding going to sleep. You look at it first thing in the morning. You waste 30 minutes just lying there, scrolling through social media. Now, in the Stoic sense, there's no real obstacle here. You can will yourself to not use your phone late at night. And you can will yourself to not pick it up first thing in the morning. That's true. So if you were living in a one-bedroom place with a very small room and you had a bedroom that took up most of the room, and no matter where you put your cell phone, you could reach it first thing in the morning, Stoicism would say, you know what, you can still work through that. However, do you need to work through that? Can you change your environment? Can you change the situation around you to make it easier? Well, try this. 1 hour before bedtime, you put your phone in another room charging. You keep it there until 1 hour after you awake in the morning. So now all of a sudden, well, I am not compelled first thing in the morning. I have to get out of bed to get to my phone. And if I'm getting out of bed to get to my phone, I just as well go use the bathroom, and I just as well drink some water, and I just as well pick up a book for 30 minutes. And there you have your morning routine. Now, for those who are thinking, well, I use my phone for my alarm clock. Well, go buy a damn alarm clock. There's alarm clock. That's a new one. Alarm clock. They are so damn cheap. Especially when you're listening to this episode, because it's going to be like in the new year. And I'm sure some people are going to be selling their old alarm clocks on Facebook Marketplace. So go have a look there. But by doing this one simple thing, you're changing your environment in a way that removes the temptation from your life, and it makes your ultimate goal of reducing cell phone use more likely. Here's some other things you can do. Use apps that stop you from opening apps after you've been on them for an hour. There's apps that will kick you off of Instagram once you've maxed out at an hour. Turn your phone on Do Not Disturb when you work. Go buy a cheap secondhand phone with no internet card and use that to listen to your music or whatever you have to listen to. The point is, you can work around that. And I gotta put this out to Shane Trotter, because Setting the Bar, that book was really the impetus for me to start doing this with my phone. I started putting my phone in the office right after reading that book, because it really made me realize just how destructive that is. So shout out to Shane. Now, let's talk about diet control. Here's another great example. Let's say you wish to eat healthier or lose weight or gain muscle. You can simply not have junk food in the house. You know, people say, well, I got these chips and they stare at me and I got to eat them. Well, you could just not buy them. The decision is made in the grocery store. That way, when you get a craving for junk food, there's a huge barrier to getting to it. You have to put your shoes on, go outside, walk or drive to the store, get the food, come home. And please, God, I hope you don't order a $2 chocolate bar on Skip the Dishes. A 10% tip on that is 20 cents. You can replace the cookies on your counter with a fruit bowl. Environmental design. Change your environment. Now, when you get a craving, you come out of your office or you come home from work and you see a fruit bowl there, you're probably going to eat a fruit as opposed to digging into the cupboard and grabbing out some junk food. But if you had junk food on the counter, you would reach for that junk food. If you're looking to gain muscle and you have to consequently up your protein take, you can have the blender or shaker and the protein powder. You can have it already on the counter for you, except for the milk. I wouldn't leave milk out overnight. You can have it all ready for you in the morning. You set a reminder on your phone to drink at a certain time of the day. Bring the protein to your workplace. Make it easy. Reduce the friction for you to do that thing. The last little example here I want to give is routine adherence, because this is one I recently came up with. I'm sorry for those tired of me talking about the ice bath. I know, but here it goes anyway. I mean, I've been doing the ice bath for a year now, pretty much every day. I would say 300 to 325 days of the last 365 days, I've done an ice bath. So I think I'm warranted a few episodes, or at least a few references to the ice bath. But I found, here's what's interesting. I've been doing it over a year. And I found that despite my good intentions, I was getting up in the morning, I was going downstairs to my ice bath, opening my stopwatch, and then staring at the freezing water for 5 minutes, for 10 minutes, for 15 minutes, staring at that cold water, not wanting to get in. And I normally wake up at 7 o'clock. Sometimes I'd be staring at that water until 7:25, 7:30, and I'm thinking, this is ridiculous. I'm a person who values productivity, and I'm starting my day staring at this water for 15 minutes. It would delay my entire morning routine. So I thought about this. Well, I could just will through it, right? I could just will through it. But here's the problem with that. I already know that I want to do it. I already know that I'm going to do it. Could I maybe muster up a bit more willpower? Sure, probably. But I could also reduce the friction needed before that, or alternatively, add friction if I don't do it in a certain period of time. Here's what I mean. Alarms. You see, I used to open my stopwatch. I'd put 3 minutes on my watch, and then when I was ready, I'd hit start and I'd go in the water. Now, the problem with that is I had to wait for when I was ready. And when are you ever going to be ready to get into 4 degrees Celsius water? Probably never. So sometimes it would take me 15, 20, 30 minutes to get quote ready, but I was never really ready anyway. So what the hell is the point? So here's what I did. Most mornings, I'm up at 7. My alarm goes off at 7 o'clock in the morning. It's right next to my bed. I turn my alarm off. I put my watch on. I go to the bathroom. I weigh myself. I grab my towel. I absolutely don't sleep in because I have another alarm at 7:07. At 7:07, I go into the ice bath. So I better be damn well sure that I'm down next to that ice bath with my towel ready to go. At 7:10, 3 minutes later, my third alarm goes off. That means I can leave the ice bath. At 7:20, my fourth alarm goes off. I have to be out of the shower because I found myself spending way too long in the shower, which is easy to justify when you've had a cold plunge in the morning. Now, the pain that comes from me not getting in when that 7:07 alarm goes off is too great. I've reduced friction before by giving myself a limit of time that I can sit here and ponder on this decision, and I've added friction afterwards, because if I don't get in at 7:07, I've missed my alarm. That means I have to snooze that alarm. That means the alarm that goes off in 3 minutes is no longer right either. I'm going to have to snooze that. That means the 7:20 alarm is going to go off at the wrong time, and I have to snooze that. Or I get like 1 minute to have a hot shower, and nobody wants just 1 minute to have a hot shower. Come on, people. So, in sum, now, the pain for me to sleep in 3 minutes is far too great. I'm not doing it. Now I have all these dumb alarms to deal with. Now, I'm not waiting for when I'm ready to get into the ice bath, because again, who is ever ready to get into a damn ice bath? I no longer wait till I'm ready to get out of bed. I have to get up. I have to get in because I'll be driving myself bloody mad with all of those 4 alarm clocks. I keep going off and I keep having to hit snooze. As you can see, technology is an external and it's morally neutral. You can use it positively or negatively. My smartwatch is not just as smart as my cell phone, but it's pretty damn smart. And that is a situation where it's been extremely useful for me. To close things off here, we can, within the practice of Stoicism, change our environment in such a way that makes success more likely. Ask yourself this: what am I not doing that I know I should be doing, that I deeply want to do, but simply am not? Make a list. Next, ask yourself, what am I doing that I know I shouldn't be doing, that I deeply don't want to do, but I find myself still doing it? Make a list. There's your challenge. There's your 2024, man. Then, using the principles of changing your environment in subtle ways, make the consequences of poor action too high. Make the number of walls that you have to go through, such as taking the protein out of the cupboard, you know, pouring the milk, grabbing and cleaning the blender, blending it. Remove all of that noise sometime before. Reduce the friction for the things that you want to do and add friction for the things that you don't want to do.